As the Daily Show's youngest correspondent, I'm most qualified to report on the fact that civics education in America sucks.
It's so bad, only 1 in 9 schools require a year of civics classes. But young activists, like members of the Providence Student Union, are demanding higher standards.
Which is why I'm here at a small Rhode Island school to interview students who are fighting to fix their education and their futures. After school spesh. What's lit, fam?
Who are you?
I'm the new transfer student. My name is Chad. I am 17.
Yeah, old as f.
No, I'm not.
You smell old.
I'm not old!
After some convincing, I gained the trust of Ahmed and Alida, the student organizers asking for better civics education in Rhode Island.
Civics is important to me because I still see that there are people that are like, voting isn't important. And I think that young people especially should also understand like the way how systems were built and how the world works.
Like, how can you go about life not knowing your rights or how to pay taxes or anything like that?
Okay, but you don't actually have to pay taxes. That's a myth.
No, you have to pay taxes. Like, you have to pay taxes.
Is this real?
That's why we need civics class in high school.
But I mean, I do civics all the time. I'm like constantly sending out civic tweets. I'm like, hashtag Green New Deal, hashtag Kony 2020. Sometimes if I just need to get all my civics in one tweet, I'll just say like hashtag woke, and then boom, civics.
That's not even close.
Wow.
You basically just talked about social media.
I mean, let's face it, we're teens. There's nothing that we can do to make our school teach us civics.
I kind of have to disagree with you on that. One, me and Ahmed are teens.
I'm sure it's not fooling anyone.
Two, me and Ahmed are suing the United States government for civics classes in all schools.
Wow.
You heard that right. My same-aged friends were suing the government for civics education in schools. Alida and Ahmed are making their case with the help of Columbia professor and oldest person I know, Michael Rebell, who's been fighting for education equity most of his career.
The U.S. Supreme Court said every child in this country has a right to an equal educational opportunity. But kids who come from low-income backgrounds, many kids of color, don't have meaningful opportunities.
So why did you decide to sue Rhode Island and not a state that everyone hates like New Jersey?
We looked at what states have the worst education system when it comes to civics, and also where would the community be supportive. If we get the Supreme Court to declare that there's a national right to education, state legislatures and school systems will act on it, it'll make a huge difference. You know, 50% of the American public cannot name the three branches of government. Can you do it?
Federal, executive, and the Supreme Court, notorious RGB.
She's one of 9 justices.
Yeah, 9, yeah. There's RGB, Chris Evans, Chris Hemsworth, Scarlett Johansson.
Wait a minute, you're mentioning all the actors in the Avengers. They are not Supreme Court justices.
I left one off, the Hulk.
Do you even know who your representative in Congress is?
It doesn't really matter about my representative because I know who my senator is. It's Bernie Sanders.
I don't think Chuck Schumer's gonna like that answer.
Who the f*** is Chuck Schumer?
He's your senator from New York. I think you've got a long ways to go on civic knowledge, I'm sorry to say.
Did I not get an education?
That's the kind of unfortunate reality that we're trying to grapple with.
Thank you for teaching me that I'm dumb.
Wait a minute, that is not the message I'm trying to get across.
I hear you loud and clear.
I'm a dumbo.
I'm dumb. I'm dumb. I'm a dumb head.
You're obviously very smart. From our conversation.
Oh my God, they were right. Boys do go to Jupiter and get more stupider.
I'm gonna be right back.
Okay.
This wise old man made me realize how—
Do you have a hall pass?
We're not in a school building right now.
Okay, well then can I go to the bathroom?
You can go to the bathroom.
Oh, sorry. May I go to the bathroom?
Of course. Okay.
So maybe us teens do need better civics education. And though this case still has a long way to go, its success will ensure future generations the education Alida and Ahmed missed out on.
The ultimate goal for me is that people are more civically engaged and, you know, we have government representation that reflects the population.
Wow. I learned so much today. And I hope you did too. Teach out.
I thought you were a teen.
Class dismissed.
Shit.
Wildfires, flash floods, and a dramatically shortened cuffing season. Climate change is affecting America, and nowhere more than Phoenix, Arizona.
In Phoenix, they say it's too hot to fly.
44 people had to be rescued.
Arizona officials are urging locals to avoid hiking during extreme heat.
So I headed to Arizona to find out for myself just how bad the heat can get. To explain the science behind my sweaty balls, I met with climate expert Brian Stone.
Climate change is very much happening today and has been with us for many decades already. If you are under the age of 34 today, every month of your life has been in a climate that is much warmer than we've seen for thousands of years.
Is that how old you are?
And third-degree burns like that are becoming the new normal here in Phoenix.
You're seeing 100 days a year with temperatures over 100 degrees.
And there have been many warnings for us that we haven't listened to leading up until this point, right?
Yeah.
Nelly has been warning us about Phoenix since 2003.
I really don't know anything about that.
Hot in her. It was sort of like this pleading cry to the public, like, it's getting hot in here, please.
Yeah.
Take off all your clothes.
Yeah.
And we didn't listen.
Maybe.
Brian walked me through some of Phoenix's new climate adaptations, like smooth, reflective surfaces, and, of course, landscaping. But the biggest change? Arizona is shifting daytime activities to night. That's right, it's gotten so hot that jogging, hiking, and even construction work are now happening after hours. What? So I went to do one of my favorite things, hang out with a bunch of guys laying pipe.
Do you do construction at night because it's more fun?
We do construction at night because it's safer. The Arizona temperatures are just too hard on the guys. If you're not prepared, well hydrated, you're gonna end up in the hospital getting IVs ran to you.
Gross. But when the sun goes down, things at the concrete pour do get a little freaky.
See the guy, he's got a vibrator on his back, and that concrete's liquid, and it vibrates the concrete, and it goes and surrounds all the rebar.
He has a vibrator on his back?
That machine right there.
Does he like clean it off before he comes to work?
Put the oil on it.
Right. Just want to make sure that we're being sanitary.
Absolutely.
But it's not all pleasuring concrete bridges to completion. Working at night can affect cognitive performance and lead to tragic accidents.
I think my phone is in there.
Climate change hasn't just affected these sex-positive village people-style jobs. It's also changing the way that people have fun. So I met up with the Arizona Trailblazers Hiking Club for a night hike.
Here's a black light for you. You can use this to try to look and see if there's any critters, scorpions, snakes.
What?
Yeah, there's lots of wildlife in these, in the floor around us.
You said, sorry, repeat that, sorry. What was that?
Scorpions, we can look for them using these black lights.
Okay, first of all, terrifying. Second, scorpions glow under black lights? I have some questions.
Why do they glow? Is it because they're covered in
I don't believe that's the reason.
And these scorpions were ready to pop off.
He's pointing his tail at you. I think you've really angered him.
Oh my God, I thought he was waving. Because he's such a little guy, he probably doesn't have venom yet, right?
Oh no, that's the worst kind.
The smaller scorpions are more venomous than the larger species.
Here's Gary,
another,
stop!
Here's another, it's real
stop! Smart. Oh my God, he picked it up. He picked it up. Gary, no. Yeah, Gary, stop!
What?
Stop!
What?
Gary, stop playing!
I hope he comes back.
Lost in the Arizona desert, it felt like things couldn't get any worse.
Oh my God. One reply on my scorpion video! Mountain Lion, come get me now!
But when the sun finally rose, I saw how beautiful Arizona looked without an iPhone flashlight on it. Must have been cool to hang out here without dying of heatstroke. Climate change might be in Arizona today, but it's coming for the rest of America. Luckily, I knew just the plan to get the government to take serious action.
I've released 100 scorpions into these chambers, and the doors are locked until you pass comprehensive climate reform. No, I don't know why they're covered in
Hi, I'm Jabuki Young White, The Daily Show's senior Rust Belt correspondent. JK, I'm gay, and so is Pittsburgh.
It's Pride Month, and Equality March is the original Pittsburgh Pride. It has bikers, pups, furries, queens, twunks, drunks, cops, bears, and fish creatures. But there's one group that not everyone is happy about.
A lot of corporations are capitalizing off Pride and off LGBTQIA+, like, merch. I don't know, they're just making a lot of money off this.
That's what the Q in LGBTQQIA stands for, corporations.
Okay.
Yeah.
But surely discriminating against our pride-loving corporations can't be the answer.
Pittsburgh Pride Equality March is for everybody. It doesn't matter who you are, where you work, or who you love.
And just so you know, we love corporations, Viacom. You're great. Keep doing what you do. We're really big fans here at The Daily Show, Viacom. Mwah. Love you.
So the answer is obviously to hug these corporations close. And corporations are hugging right back. Google, KPMG, Aetna, Lyft, not Chick-fil-A, and here comes the true sleigh queen, Walmart.
Is Walmart gay?
Walmart does take pride in their gay associates as a company. I don't think you can label a company with a sexual orientation.
Walmart seems like a top to me.
I would agree with that.
Yeah. I think it's amazing that so many people could come out and just live their truth as a marketable demographic.
For sure. And they really made it like a safe place for everybody, I think, for us too.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah, 100%. It's like, here I am. I'm queer. Yeah. I have a debit
Everyone's
card.
Everyone's gay as hell now. And, and gays love money, bitch. You
right,
know that, so.
Right.
So queer capitalism is totally chill? Actually, there is a specific issue with corporate sponsorship in Pittsburgh, and it involves the F word. No, not that. Fracking.
There's a lot of corporations that are seemingly buying. Last year, this march was called the EQT Equality March. EQT doesn't stand for equality, it stands for they're a fracking company.
Do you think that it's appropriate that a fracking company is a sponsor for Pittsburgh Pride?
Lol. I think that it is completely inappropriate that a fracking company is a sponsor for anything.
EQT doesn't just shoot hot liquid deep into holes in the ground. They also swing both ways by supporting Pride and various anti-gay politicians. So what are people supposed to do? Have a separate pride without corporate sponsors? Some say, frack yes.
This pride event represents the people, non-corporational pride, something that centers our TLGBTQ communities of Pittsburgh.
Do you think corporations can be gay people?
No, corporations cannot be gay people.
The People's Pride is non-corporate, has more color in its rainbow, and I found someone who can keep up with my moves. But are they turning their back on progress?
Don't you think it's beautiful that queer people have been able to come out and live their truth as a marketable, capitalizing demographic?
No. I would think it would be beautiful if those actions were genuine. They want to be a part of what's trending right now. Right now, being gay is trendy, you know? Pose is out, and there are lots of gay celebrities now.
Could you name a couple by any chance?
So off top of my head right now, Big Frida.
Okay.
There's Deshaun Wesley and Naomi Maldonado.
Okay, right.
They don't even want my brand. This is where I draw the line. There has to be some way for corporations like EQT to prove that they're really committed and not just experimenting.
Like, maybe they just need to show that they're really about queer subculture in like a more inventive, creative way. So
I'm afraid where you're going with this.
I thought that maybe this could really get across the message of what EQT stands for. It's like drilling, but also
it's a little fast. Could you slow it down? maybe that.
That's right. Progress takes time. 50 years ago, corporations wouldn't touch the gay community, and now they can't wait to show their love in public. And what better way to reciprocate that love than with the EQT Very Speed Deep Fracking Drill Dunk, brought to you by EQT.
With a vaccine still about a year away, medical experts are looking at other ways to treat COVID-19 patients. And there's one thing right now that seems to be working.
Convalescent plasma?
Convalescent plasma.
Convalescent plasma.
Plasma? Actually, the plasma of recovered COVID patients, it's the one thing right now more valuable than toilet paper. If you've recovered from COVID-19, doctors want your blood. So I sat down with two people who might be able to help. Do you still have COVID, or like, how does that work?
No, I'm good. I was cleared. I've been without symptoms for about 30 some days now.
So I've been symptom free from coronavirus for about 3 weeks and I'm basically recovered.
So can you explain to me what convalescent plasma treatment is?
Yeah, that's where people donate plasma to get people better.
Oh, okay. Right. That's the therapy that Madonna uses on her face where she takes the blood of her 20-year-old lovers to look younger. Okay.
So it's not exactly that, but what happens is people who have coronavirus, their immune systems develop antibodies against the virus, and the treatment gives those antibodies to people who are dying from the disease so that the antibodies can fight the virus for them so they recover more quickly.
Wow, that's really dope that you donated plasma and took time to think about other people during a pandemic. That's pretty laudable.
We didn't.
Yes, it's not quite that easy.
Whoa, why is that?
I'm gay.
I'm gay too, and the FDA says that we are not allowed to donate blood.
So you can't donate blood because you're gay?
Pretty much.
Oh, shit. Here we go.
Back in 1983, the FDA banned gay men from donating blood. This was during the AIDS crisis, which was another disease that the government didn't do shit about until it was far too late. In 2015, that ban was lifted. But if a gay man wanted to donate blood, he just couldn't have sex for 12 months. That's some straight up Mike Pence shit right there. But now, in the middle of this pandemic, the FDA relaxed their bullshit policy to 3 months of abstinence. That's like an entire cuffing season. Like, where are you gonna find a man who hasn't had sex in 3 months?
So I'm actually eligible to donate for the first time since I was 18.
Oh, boom!
So after a few rounds of screenings, I was given an appointment to donate.
So what are gay blood drives like now? Like, is everybody on Molly and listening to the new Dua Lipa album?
Yeah, it wasn't quite like that. After I arrived and was preparing to donate through the New York Blood Center, they asked me why I hadn't donated since I was 18. I volunteered I was gay, and that's when they told me they're not yet recognizing the new relaxed deferral, and so they weren't willing to accept my donation.
Wow, they are making it really hard for you guys. You know, if you want them to take your blood, you can't just reveal that you're gay. You're gonna have to pass as a straight guy.
What do straight people look like?
Okay, so first, Lucas, let's take a look at your outfit. I'm gonna need you to stand up and twirl around, not twirl, spin around.
Okay, so I've got this.
Okay, is this your straightest outfit right now? Your look should kind of say, I'm looking for a girlfriend to shop for me because I can't shop for myself. That should, also, do you have any clothes that your mom bought you?
No, I don't.
No?
No.
Plaid? Do you have any plaid? Any plaid? More plaid? No plaid?
Yeah, but it's really cute. It fits like exactly.
No. Yeah. How about any bootcut jeans?
No, I mean straight cut.
Do you have any shoes that look like they're too casual for formal events and then too formal for casual events and they're scuffed up and they look like they're the only shoes that you've owned for the past decade? Yeah, never mind, Lucas, never mind. You can have a seat. Okay. Let me hear you say, just say bro.
Like if I say, take my blood, brah.
Brah. And there it is. Wow, I'm there. SoCal, skater, you know, 90, I'm there and I'm sold. I believe it.
Yeah, the thing is we shouldn't have to pass as straight, right?
What do you mean, Jack?
So being gay or bisexual isn't a real risk factor for HIV. Say you have a straight man who's had sex with 100 women in the past month and never used a condom, that person can still donate blood. But if there is a gay man who's been having sex with his husband and wearing condoms consistently, that person can't.
Yeah, I think at the end of the day, we need science and not stigma to make decisions about donor eligibility.
The FDA is sending this message again that if you're gay, the only way that you can be a good, clean, charitable person, the kind of person who donates blood, is if you don't have sex.
So until the FDA comes around, we'll just have to keep our fine, fabulous blood all to ourselves.
For years, grumpy old white dudes have been telling us that socialism is total bullshit.
Socialism leads to decline and ruin.
This system crushes human souls.
But as The Daily Show's new senior youth correspondent, I know that millennials right now think socialism is totally on trend. I pop Somali and hit the street to find out why, even though the olds hate it, the kids love socialism.
I think socialism is great. I think you should definitely help whoever you could at any situation.
I f*** with socialism just because I f*** with anything that's helping black people out.
Okay, so you're socialism curious.
Yeah, a little. I'm in college.
Right.
Do you hate billionaires?
Low-key, yeah. You look at Jeff Bezos, he doesn't look human.
I mean, I think the idea of socialism is on point. I mean, I don't really know what socialism means, to be completely honest with you.
Oh, it's okay. We're all confused. If there were only someone we could talk to, someone with some deep experience on the subject.
When I started doing this sort of piece on socialism, I knew that there was really only one politician who I could talk to about it. So I guess my question is, do you know AOC?
Sure.
And what's her availability like, if you could put us in touch, maybe?
But you want to speak to her?
Yeah, maybe. Well, I just figured, you know.
Seriously, you can't talk socialism in America without going to the OG, Senator Bernie Sanders.
I believe in a society where all people do well, not just a handful of billionaires.
Could he be the oldest millennial in America?
You know that capitalism has given us a bunch of really dope things, right? iPhones, cars, hamburgers, the Avengers movies, the opioid crisis. So why are young people like myself very open to socialism?
Your generation, the younger generation, will in all likelihood have a lower standard of living than your parents. Your generation is leaving school more deeply in debt, having a much harder time finding affordable housing. The jobs that you get will pay less. So the idea of creating a society with more egalitarianism, I think, is very appealing to young people.
Okay. Yeah, I feel the burn. I see what you're talking about now.
I admit it, democratic socialism looks pretty fine on his Tinder profile, but are we gonna vibe when we meet IRL?
If you go to countries like Denmark or Sweden, you're gonna see very little poverty. You could leave your job, you could start a new business. You and your family still have healthcare as a right.
So I could quit The Daily Show and be fine?
Absolutely.
Well, it was great meeting with you.
So under President Bernie, we'd be more European, like Denmark or Narnia. But try telling that to the haters.
It's a terrible system. It's never worked. And in order for it to work at all, you got to kill several million people to make it work.
Carol Markowitz has written on why socialism needs to be canceled forever, period.
Millennials have been raised in such prosperous times. They just think that, oh, we can make it even better with this insane plan to share the resources.
You know, I would love capitalism if it just weren't for all the sick people and all the poor people who can't afford healthcare. Is there a way for me to enjoy capitalism without those things?
If the solution is socialism, it's gonna make us all equal in our poverty.
But if everyone is poor, isn't that kind of cool? Because we're all experiencing the same things. It'll be like, hey, like, the bread line was extra long today. And I'd be like, oh my God, yeah, it was. That guy's super observant and, like, funny.
Not so much, no. I was born in the Soviet Union. My great-grandfather was killed in a gulag because he owned a business and socialists decided that was no longer legal.
That's truly horrific. Would Bernie be sending small business owners to forced labor camps?
Obviously, Soviet Union was an authoritarian society with no democratic rights. And I think if you know history, you'll know that democratic socialists stood up and fought against that. You can look about what existed in the Soviet Union or in Venezuela. That is not what I'm talking about at all.
So no one's going to the gulag?
Well, except no.
Okay.
Fact check. The examples of failed socialism that critics use are not socialist democracies, but authoritarian states led by corrupt, ruthless, and paranoid dictators. But I do have one real problem with socialism. I like money.
You know, TV's going kind of good for me right now, and I'm thinking of writing a successful book. Is socialism still for me if I'm a millennial millionaire?
I mean, it depends on what's your heart. If what you say in your life is all I want to do is make as much money as I possibly can and screw everything else, I don't give a damn. Yeah, no, I don't think democratic socialism is your cup of tea. But if you have a decent heart and you say, look, I'm doing really well, but you know what? I also want to be a contributor to the well-being of society. So I'm going to pay my fair share of taxes.
Wow, I could have my CBD-infused gluten-free cake and eat it too. I'm liking the socialism thing more and more. And Bernie made me feel so good, I decided to share something.
I brought you a present.
That's cool.
So.
All right, anticipating. Oh, that's beautiful.
Yeah, thank you, I made it myself. When you are elected president, where do you think you're gonna put this in the White House?
I live someplace. I don't know the exact room, but it's beautiful and I thank you for it.
You're welcome, Bernie. Enjoy.
I'm here in New York City, gay capital of the world, except for Berlin, San Francisco, or Congress. Here to talk to some LGBTQ voters.
Anyway, I've come to the Leslie Lohman to talk with LGBTQ voters about finally getting the gay presidential candidate we've all dreamed of. So if someone told you 10 years ago that there was going to be a gay presidential candidate, how do you feel like you would have reacted? Because I know for me, I would have been like, who told you I'm gay? Was it Kevin?
I would have believed it, but I would think it would be a woman, though.
10 years ago, Barack Obama was still evolving about marriage. It's a real leap to think that 10 years later, we would have a viable queer candidate for president of the United States.
But being proud of Pete doesn't mean that we're voting for him. Raise your hand if you plan on voting for Mayor Pete in the primary.
I don't think it's possible for me.
There's nothing that he could do to make you vote for him?
No.
Our community actually has a bit of a shameful history in the sense that gay white men have historically marginalized the contributions of trans women and trans men and people of color.
I'm trans, and in, you know, knowing that there's gonna be a cis gay presidential candidate doesn't do anything to make my life any safer as a trans woman.
And that's the divide. According to my unofficial poll, the type of gay you are determines whether you trust Pete to represent you. A lot of people will say that he's not queer enough, or he's not gay enough.
What does
that
even mean?
He's gay enough if we can hold his feet to the fire to make sure that our voices are heard.
I live in South Bend, and I work with Black Lives Matter South Bend, and they don't have trust for Pete.
So you want him to wear a leather harness, and you want him and Chasen to open their relationship, and you want them to be poly.
We just want him to actually pay attention to the policing problem.
I had a face-to-face with him, and I asked him, what are you doing about the police brutality in Indiana? And he kept saying, well, this is what I want you to do. I want you to push me. I don't need to push you. You know what needs to be done.
Okay, so you're not asking him to be more gay. You just want him to care about the margins.
Correct. I want him to care about the margins and leave the doctors at home.
Pete's rainbow booty shorts are actually just a pair of relaxed fit Dockers, which is why I wonder if his mainstream appeal is that you can kind of forget he's gay. As much as we can say that Pete's brand of queerness has problematic aspects, don't you think that that actually makes him electable? For example, look at this.
That is my brand of queerness. We don't have a picket fence, but that looks like a picture of my husband and me.
The word that's not there is first gay family. You know, the word that's there is first family. That is something America can get behind, I think.
I see it as a disappointingly sanitized version of what it means to be gay.
To a lot of critics, this looks like this.
Oh.
They're less a gay couple and more so just like two guys who decided to make granola in their kitchen.
They're clearly gay. And if that's not gay enough for the people in this country, I don't know what would be.
So it sounds like the takeaway of this conversation should be, if Buttigieg does not eat his husband's ass on live TV, he is not gay enough for me.
I'm out.
How about this? Gay people, we're basically straight.
No. I mean, the takeaway is also that for a lot of voters, you can't just choose gay. You also have to think about your race.
Okay, Pete Buttigieg. Black people don't like him because of the police stuff and homophobia or something.
No, black people like him. And a lot of black people don't.
Pete Buttigieg. A lot of black people don't like him, but some do.
Can you imagine how fun it will be to watch a gay, married Midwestern mayor destroy Donald Trump?
Okay, I hear you. Pete Buttigieg, I'm taking Trump to Pound Town.
No one wants to see that.
No.
So then what is it?
I think the takeaway should be that the LGBT community is not a monolith, and you know, the first gay presidential candidate means very different things to very different people in our community.
Whether you believe Pete is the visibility we spent decades fighting for, or just another centrist white guy who's easy on the eyes and the police, the gay community is making it clear. If you want our vote, you better work, bitch.
I'm not saying that. I can't say that. What the does that even mean?
Oh